It's hour three of the Nutri-Medical Report Thursday, live the 12th of June. And Thursday, I'll tell you, I want to just give an advanced report from what Chris. He'll be on for probably a few minutes, but we want you on the full hour, Tim. The concern over full plutonium flash at the WIP nuclear site triggering disaster that spreads to multiple waste drums. Plutonium-239. This is the main radioactive isotope and container that exploded. Anonymous employee, the warnings were ignored. They put us in danger. They had a nuclear explosion triggered off by this green kitty litter ordered by Obama and the Department of Energy to try to go green. But we're going to expand on that later.
This is the kind of news. The most dangerous substance on Earth.
Known to man. Yeah, exactly. Yep. One atom will kill you. Welcome back to the Nutri-Medical Report. And if you look at the front page of Drudge, you'll see it says that Baghdad is ready to fall. You know, this is nightmarish, and I don't think people realize how serious and significant it is. The fall of Baghdad is designed to be the bear trap for Russia and Iran to start this big war. And that means that that Muhammad or Ali, who is a devout Muslim, doesn't really want to harm anybody, but he will follow orders. And he's going to get his prayer mat out before this refrigerator in Chicago or Atlanta or New Los Angeles. And he's going to go to the lyophilized flask in the back, and he's got probably a master's level in infectious disease at some university, probably highly qualified. And he'll pull that vial out, and he's going to start spraying it. If this war gets going, you're going to see Americans dying like flies from stupid super weapons caused by our government having an idiot policy thinking that we can whack them, but they can't hurt us. And, of course, the same thing goes with our policy toward dealing with nuclear seismic testing, which shows most of our nuclear reactors can't withstand an earthquake, which we're going to talk about in a minute with Chris Harris, with Fukushima and with WIP reactors in Carlsbad, New Mexico, where we now have a report that Chris sent me. Now, Chris, I'd like, rather than steal your thunder, I want you to read it. We talked about it briefly earlier, about the WIP reactor nuclear site and plutonium-239 actually causing a nuclear explosion. And, of course, the anonymous employee saying they put us in danger. Tell us about the WIP reactor and what's going on there.
Hello, Dr. Bill. Well, in the WIP reactor, now remember, this report, there was a potential for the plutonium flash, which is a criticality event. I haven't done the analysis on that myself. So let's just go talk about what is. What is that the Department of Energy had a decision to cut back on the waste isolation pilot plant's safety requirements to save some money. And in that, they have also decided to make some changes to the packing material that's used in these highly radioactive waste drums, which contain plutonium salts. And they used an organic material instead of a non-organic material. And I was just talking it over today with one of my colleagues, who is very esteemed in waste handling and waste processing. You know, we'll call him Barney for now. But he basically says, is that what they did? They put organic material in? That's a hydrogen explosion. And yeah. So, you know, in the presence,
but a hydrogen explosion can trigger criticality. Well, most people don't realize the Krytron switches that cause that use C4 plastic, which is what they used to try to detonate the nuclear weapons back in the 1930s and 40s. They were actually using Krytron high-speed flash switches so they could simultaneously detonate and compress the ball of plutonium to create a nuclear explosion or criticality. When you have a hydrogen explosion, you can likewise create criticality. And what it does is it temporarily increases the neutron flux that causes a chain reaction, and that causes an explosion. So that's how it can happen. Hydrogen-triggered plutonium-239 nuclear explosions can be triggered by hydrogen, right?
That's right. It all would depend, you know, whether they're going to achieve a critical mass or not, and there's, like, different categories of the criticality.
Yeah, but it may only be partial. Maybe it's not, right. You know, it's not clean, so it's only, like, 2% of the total mass of plutonium. But enough flux occurs, you get what's called a neutron flux, and then, of course, it blows up the bomb and disperses all the isotopes all over Hell's Half Acre. So this is what happened with these kitty litter, these green kitty litter from the Department of Energy and the Obama administration. They went green, all right, but the green, unfortunately, was like the, you know, the goblin from, you know, Spider-Man.
Yeah.
The green was nuclear. It was a bad idea. It was turning these things literally into cooking bombs. Crazy.
It didn't have to happen this way. And
right.
What I'm also finding is that what part of the cutbacks, well, they lost track of specific drums and their locations in big vaults known as panels.
Right.
And so you really don't know where all this material is.
They didn't properly log it. In other words, they didn't log the material properly to be able to track it to which ones they modified with the new green kitty litter, did it?
No, I was, you know what, I was thinking, well, you know, they have impeccable records, and I just know the way that we do things, and you know,
they should be done.
It makes sense. It should be done right, and I guess I was wrong. That it's done in a
Well, you guys are impeccable because you're the safety guys who come in to clean up the mess or do a proper evaluation. That's the next question. The seismic testing here in America with the NRC started by Jasco before he was replaced because he was opening too many cans of worms. What's happening there? Have they finished their evaluation of all these nuclear plants and said, guess what, they all fail, or we're going to study a lot more? What's the outcome? What's going on with all these nuclear plants?
Several have failed outright where there's going to be modifications have to be made. I got to go ahead and write you a synopsis of those so that you have an idea. Others can be wished away, provided that there's enough analysis. Wished away is a term we use where you talk about sharpening the pencils and all that. However, it's still that's a lot of work in itself to sell that. You know, you have to actually sell it that you are safe because you have this much margin of safety in the build of your plant.
They should have data, though. I mentioned before they should have soil quality data, data on the structural integrity of welds, crystal data with basically X-ray and ultrasound of all the joints and welds and rivets. They should know the structural integrity of pipes that might be thinned out. They did a couple of years ago. They're actually trying to use a brush to clean out pipes in a nuclear reactor near Chicago. I'm trying to remember the name of the plant. I think we talked about this, and the actual brush went through the pipe. It's like, well, the brush should not go through the pipe. It actually punctured right through the wall of it, trying to clean it out.
Yes, it did.
What plant was that again?
I think that was Braidwood.
The Braidwood plant, yeah.
Yeah.
So, we're starting to build up a kind of a library. And by the way, this will be all in our book, which is going to include all the emails back and forth from Chris, all the analysis, other nuclear experts, plant pictures, diagrams, everything, and so we have actual site-specific engineering design things that can fix Fukushima. By the way, the other report that I have is that that the ice wall, they're really, really starting to back off on the ice wall. What's the story there in Fukushima?
Okay, once again, I would talk to, a colleague of mine who is an expert in the area of cleanup, because he was on the Three Mile Island cleanup project and all that. He is a renowned expert, and I said, well, what do you think of this ice wall? He just curled his lip and goes, nah, that's not going to get it. You know, he's that kind of a guy. So, you know, he's very candid and very open. And I got to tell you what, he said, what they need is coffer dams that you could pump out from in between the two dams. So it's a coffer dam is actually two dams in a row. And actually, that makes a lot of sense to me. And so you could keep pumping out from in between these, so you build like a big cofferdam around the plant of a material that's not ice, if you know what I mean. It's going to be a more steel. It's going to be a real robust structure, and they haven't entertained that yet. But you're basically, they're wasting their time with the ice wall. And plus, you know, the added negatives of shifting. Liquefying material, liquefying the ground around it, where you can cause sinkholes and other, you know, believe me, they don't need any more problems than they already have. But, and they can also create more problems with an ice dam.
Exactly. And, of course, the ice dam is supposed to be above it. They should use Starlight, which I mentioned. I got the original information for Dr. Ron Klatz, head of A4M. Starlight will withstand 15 to 20,000 degree temperatures, is radiation resistant, won't crystallize and break down. And if they put a Starlight dam above it, they could divert the water away from the plant Then they consider seawall below it, filter that material out, turn it into solid radioactive waste, dispose of it in double-hulled ships, taking it away to a zinc mine as the deepest mine possible.
Uranium, what do you do with any of it? It's all poisonous, but...
Yeah. Welcome back, and we have more than 50% of the fuel run assemblies transferred. That's 1,034 out of 1,533. Chris and Ed, these fuel rod assemblies, they've managed to get the easy ones. They're going to have more difficulty with the harder ones. And also the problem is, as you mentioned before, the seal on the overall fuel rod pool, cooling pool number four, the common cooling pool they haven't touched. And, of course, the reactors one, two, and three, they really can't touch. So this mess isn't going to go away. And aquarium is probably 75 feet at least, or 25 meters below the plant. It's generating highly radioactive or tritiated water, which is superheated. It's generating criticality, which emerges from the ground and shoots neutron beams, which turn the air blue with beams of gamma rays that literally ionize the nitrogen. You can see blue beams above the Fukushima plant in the after sundown. This situation is extremely unstable. And I don't know where they're getting people, but, you know, after a period of time, these people get so sick, they have to get new people. I guess the Yakuza and the supply them with enough people willing to do these things that are, in a sense, committing radioactive suicide. We have specific plans that we talked about to fix each of these areas. And the first thing is a starlight wall above it to divert the water. The second is to put in a sealed seawall area below it to catch all the water before it goes out in the ocean. It's also to make sure they use ground-penetrating radar and block off all the steam vents that actually are superheated steam driving vented radioactive hot tritiated steam out toward the ocean floor that vents radiation across the ocean floor, which they could do with GPR, ground-penetrating radar. I think that they need to put underneath these reactors what I call boronated water and then hit it with the scalar frequency of boron, and then basically form a supercrystalline and dry it out, literally turn it into a crystalline sarcophagus, and stop trying to move things. I think that the idea of moving things is dangerous, other than the water that they have there, which they could do a multi-stage filter, which would include a sediment, linear charcoal, reverse osmosis, and an ion exchange resin. On a large scale, the system we use for pure water systems, which basically came from industry. And they tried to do this with the ALPS, but the incompetence that were doing ALPS were the same incompetence that did the kitty litter, green kitty litter, that created the turned the literally into nuclear bombs. I can't believe they did this. They turned the WIP reactor storage containers into hydrogen-generating bombs that could then compress the plutonium-239 and create a partial criticality reaction, literally a nuclear explosion that would blow these containers all over the place. And that's what happened. So, Chris, what's going to happen in Fukushima? What's next?
Well, in the big picture, is still getting the advanced liquid processing system running up and running. But, you know, you're also talking about what used to be a 10-year projected cleanup that turned into a 20-year, and now I'm reading 50-year projected cleanup, you know.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're not really making any progress even on the news reports. And when I go over, and you can go over, for example, to if you go over to Jeff Rentz's site and you look at what his latest news reports are, I don't see a lot of what I call real progress. I see a lot of hand-wringing. We see the West Coast near starfish near extinction. No one says rad. Post-Fukushima radiation near West Coast rising. Japan new professor... R4 SPF flooring could go at any time. That's the reactor 4 cooling pool. The floor could drop, which is what you talked about. The tritium density in bypass well way over limit, which is a bypass well to bypass the water that's coming above the plant. Were there even before they built Fukushima. Aerial photo shows desolation around Daiichi. Happy Fukushima video. Radiation good for you. Isn't that crazy? Will fracking cause our next nuclear disaster? By the way, fracking, I think, was part of the reason why these plants went, besides the stupid idea that they had to green them, they were fracking, which caused you know, pumping water and chemicals down around this site, which is literally a quarter, half mile from the WIP plant. I think that's, when you have a salt mine, why would you allow fracking? That's so crazy, isn't it? And, of course, by the way, fracking here in America is often near nuclear plants. It also can trigger off new earthquakes. We know that the Department of Mines in Colorado in the late 80s actually triggered off a 4-point-something earthquake just by pumping in water in the fault lines in up north of Denver, in Boulder. I can't believe they did that, but they said, oh, bad idea. The Department of Mines realized we can make earthquakes, too. And, you know, what I think is going to happen is the radiation isotopes are going to increase in density. And here's where I want to turn the question over to Tim. Tim, if they strike militarily, how likely is it they're going to strike the Bashar reactor? And what would be the consequences of hitting a large, older-style, designed in the 70s, large nuclear reactor with lots of fuel rods, etc., with a live bunker buster nuke that literally completely cracked the reactor core?
Well, a whole lot of deaths, and that includes deaths going all the way into China, because we're at the immediate area, you know, will be extremely hot.
Physicians for social responsibility calculated out.
Take it to the east, northeast.
Yeah.
And that will literally take it all the way to China. And when I say take it, I'm talking about lots of deaths.
Right. How likely is it that what will happen if they strike the Bashar reactor, Chris, with a, you know, bunker buster nukes, you know, GB-54, you know, to blast the nuclear reactor core all the little bits? What'll happen?
Oh, well, then you will have, if they all have to use a bunker buster, sure, you could expect core damage. And then
Right, and the core damage will be so catastrophic. Our physicians for social responsibility and our nuclear experts, because I've belonged to them for many years, have basically said this radiation cloud will cross Myanmar, which is, it'll cross China, it'll cross the South China Sea, it'll cross Korea, it'll cross over Japan, and then it'll head toward us. And we're going to get blasted with radiation if these morons do this. That's us and the Israelis planning on hitting a live nuclear reactor with nuclear weapons. And also all their so-called storage sites with bunker buster nukes to hit them that are actually have underground centrifuges, which, you know, if it's down deep enough, it may not be a lot of local radiation, but there's going to be some. But hitting a live reactor, that's going to be very catastrophic. It'll also pull Russia and China into a full-force conflict. So hitting a live reactor will be, okay, that's it. Nukes are flying.
Don't forget that the Israelis have a reactor that's at the center of their nuclear industry, and it can also be hit. And the Syrians have the Icelander in Russian missile, which virtually cannot be stopped by anything they have or we have, and it can pinpoint target their key reactor, Dimona.
Yeah.
And if that goes, basically most of Israel goes. You don't have to nuke Israel, you just have to bomb their reactor.
Now, Chris, have we had any progress on the nuclear site from JASCO in terms of the nuclear seismic testing on these reactors here in America?
We're getting more of the updates as they come
But getting them, does it mean that anything concrete is happening? Have they gone in and say, we're spending this money, we're going to fix this, we're going to fix that, anywhere?
You're talking about actually digging and
doing stuff.
There's
there's hand-wringing, there's reports of, we needed another report because this report doesn't look so good, so we better do another report. So basically it's like the Kachina dolls. This little Kachina doll doesn't look good, so we're going to put it inside another doll and make another doll inside the doll. So basically, we'll write another report on the report because the last one was scary enough that we should write another report.
I will let you know when I see a real design, a design change, and the amount of effort that it would take to do it, an actual, you know, contract being released.
I'll call it Countdown to AF, American Fukushima. Countdown to AF. All we don't even need to have tsunami. But there are tsunami potentials. For example, Cumbre Vieja and the Azores. If that strikes the coast of the United States, we're going to have a number of reactors that are going to go postal. Some of that water can go up to 100 to 300 miles inland if it's 800 feet high. which is what the nuclear with tsunami experts in Zurich, Switzerland, and then here in Northern California at the Tsunami Research Center have found. So, not so good. And, of course, if we attack Russia, Russia can set off Cumbre Viejo very easily. All they have to do is drop a conventional bomb or a small nuke, and
here's the breaking news. Iran is deploying forces to fight the Al-Qaeda militants in Iraq. Wow. Revolutionary Guard forces are going in to help the Iraqi troops.
Well, that
this
means
is
it's
the
on.
The trap for Iran that I've been talking about.
I don't think they could avoid it, though. I think that they now know that there's no choice. But yeah. Our troops and our forces can't respond, and Obama will not have the military oomph to move forward. I think he's going to have a real problem with trying to get this authorized.
Oh, yeah. Go on. Click the subscribe button.
We need to get subscribed and get this unity stronger and beat YouTube at their own game. Okay, that's what this is about. Like I say, go to the remix button, hit the remix button. That way you'll have this video and keep up with this. Otherwise, you know, YouTube's just going to control us, guys, and it's really bad.